Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. What a privilege and an honor it is to be in the house of the Lord just one more time. Hallelujah. Somebody give God the greatest praise that you can give him on this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody lift your voices in a shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Hallelujah. We are still here. We're still in the land of the living. And we thank God for everything that he has done for us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, you're great and you're greatly to be praised. God, we feel your presence. God, we know that you're near. God, we know that you're with us. God, we thank you for your healing. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your spirit. Hallelujah. We thank you for covering our city, for covering our church members, for covering our families, for covering our households. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody, lift up a praise in your home, at your jobs, in your cars. Hallelujah. He is great and greatly to be praised. Magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Hallelujah. 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 We came to have church on this morning. We came to glorify the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Because he is great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. So wherever you are, we want you to join in with us this morning, because he's done so much. Hallelujah. He deserves all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. It belongs to him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Let's have a praise party in here this morning. Let's have a praise party. Giving God all the glory, God. You deserve all the praise, God. Hallelujah, God. Bless your name. Thank you.
Hallelujah. 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 There's only one God. There's only one. 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 Hallelujah. And we worship him today. We give him all the glory. Hallelujah. As his presence fills this room, we give him everything that we have. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We just want to bow. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Consuming fire.
Consuming fire.
Sweet. We are moments away from hearing from the senior pastor of Christ Memorial Baptist Church. Pastor Broxton is a leader who is passionate, sincere, and one who loves to share the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout the community and abroad. He is a dynamic teacher and preacher who has led Christ Memorial Baptist Church for more than 28 years. Pastor Broxton is a visionary, and he encourages you to approach life being faithful and true to the will of God for your life. His heart of compassion helps encourage those who have gone astray and empowers believers to reach their destiny. Above all, he loves God and is a devoted husband, father, and grandfather who loves and supports his family. Let's welcome Pastor Larry Broxton.
The name of Jesus. It feels good to be in the house of the Lord once again, and to everyone that is with us this morning through whichever media that you use, we are so honored that you tuned in this morning. If you have your Bibles, turn with me, if you will, to the book of 1 John, chapter 1. 1 John, chapter 1, beginning at verse 7. 1 John 1 and 7. And it reads as follows. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Bless the word of the Lord. I want to talk for a few minutes this morning under the subject, the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. We now live in a day in which people both in and out of the church feel we no longer need salvation through Christ and the cross. Mainline denominations are proclaiming a new gospel and ignoring to the point of outright rejecting the message of salvation through the blood of Christ. Some even have gone as far as no longer allowing their church choir to sing songs about the blood. Well, it doesn't matter what people in or out of the church say. What matters is what the Word of God says. Our text says that the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. Just as a live body becomes a corpse when drained of its blood, faith without the saving blood of Jesus Christ is dead faith. The blood of Christ is the bedrock of what we say and do as born-again believers. The church, the Bible, the gospel, and our faith is worthless without the blood. But this morning, I stand before you to proclaim that the blood has not, I repeat, the blood has not lost its power. I believe I can speak for other true saints who are watching this telecast. Other folk can walk away from the truth, but we are staying under the blood. The so-called modern gospel preachers, they can preach against it. They can call it outdated, barbaric, or undignified, all they want. But as for me and some folks I know that are watching this morning, we are staying under the blood. The songwriter got it right when he wrote, "I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood that saved me. One day when I was lost, Jesus died on the cross, and I know it was the blood that saved me." So if someone is watching this with you, you need to tell them, if it wasn't for the blood, I wouldn't be here today. The Bible says in 1 Peter 1 and 20 that Jesus was chosen before the creation of the world to give his life, but it was revealed in these last days for our sake. Scripture lets us know that Jesus was preordained before the world was ever created to become the ultimate sacrifice for sin. Of all the wonderful things he did on earth, The greatest of these was God becoming man. Jesus fulfilled what was written about him in the Old Testament. He was born of a virgin, born in Bethlehem. He was a descendant of King David. He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He was a man of passion, a man of miracles who reached out to fallen men. He lived a sinless life. He taught us a better way to live. He defended truth and righteousness, and he perfectly revealed God the Father in a way man had never known before. 1 Peter 1 and 21 goes on to say that through Jesus, we believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and that our faith and hope will be in God. While on earth, Jesus did so many things, John declared that if everything he did was written down, the world couldn't contain the books. But he didn't become our Savior until he climbed up Calvary's hill and was nailed to the cross and shed his precious blood. It wasn't his life and his teaching that saved man's soul, it was his blood. For without the shedding of the blood, the Bible says there's no forgiveness of sin. In other words, and I'm going to say it plain, if you are not under the blood, you are still under God's curse. You can be a member of a church from the day you was in Pampers till the day they roll you out in a wheelchair or a casket. But if you're not under blood, you're still under the curse. You can be a member of a church for 25 days or 25 years, but if you're not under the blood, you are still under the curse. It don't matter whether you got a position in the church, whether you sing in the choir, you on the usher board or the mother board or whatever board. If you are not under the blood, you are still under the curse. I know you paying your tithes, and thank God for that, and you're there every Sunday, and you're a very faithful member. But if you are not under the blood, you are still under the curse. You can get mad at me all you want, but if you got an issue, take it up with the one who wrote this book. If you are not under the blood, you are still under the curse. The blood cleanses us from sins of the past. Whatever sin a person has committed in the past, the blood of Jesus can cleanse it. People want to reform and they want to change their way of living and turn over a new leaf. But you see, the problem is their past sins are still on the books. But there is a solution. By the blood of Jesus, God promises that he will blot out like a thick cloud our transgressions and our sins. He promised that as far as the east is from the west is how far he will remove our transgressions from us. He promised that he would be merciful to our unrighteousness and our sins and iniquities, and he would remember them no more. So what I want to encourage somebody, no matter what you've done in the past, from the day you were born up to the day you got saved, the blood will wipe away all sin. The blood cleanses us from sins of the present. Now understand something, and hear me very clear. Salvation does not give us a license to sin. You don't have to sin, but because we still have free will, we're no longer practicing sinners. The blood took care of that, but because we still got free will, we can still commit a sin. But if you do, take it to the Lord in prayer. For the Bible says in verse 9 of our text that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Listen, when you signed up for Jesus, you became a soldier of the cross. And our Christian walk is a battle, and the only victory we have is in Christ Jesus and what he did on Calvary. Not only did the blood wash away our sins when we got saved, from then on, if we allow him to, he will do a daily cleansing and a daily washing. The blood cleanses us not only from past sins, present sins, but also from possible sins. Any sin that you would or could ever possibly commit, once you confess it, the blood of Jesus will clean it up. That ought to make somebody happy in the Holy Ghost this morning. But understand, this is nothing new. It's always been God's plan. Even in the Old Testament, when God gave worship guidelines to Israel, he demanded a blood sacrifice. Yet, with all the millions of gallons of animal blood that was shed over thousands of years, not one single sin was washed away, and it hasn't changed even in the New Testament. Hebrews 10 and 4 says that it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Their blood only covered sin until the time when Jesus would go to the cross. Religion, good works, wishful thinking, and making sincere promises just won't do it. Only the blood of Jesus can wash away sins. Only the blood can seal our salvation. The blood promises absolute security. Jesus said he gives us eternal life and we shall never perish, for nobody can snatch us out of his hand. That's why we ought to take about 20 or 25 seconds to praise and thank God for what only the blood was able to do. Somebody ought to praise God. And let's be for real. We need the blood because the devil has a plan for every person watching this service. What plan is that? Police calls it robbery homicide. Jesus said in John 10:10 that the thief comes only to steal, to kill, and destroy. Now the word thief comes from the Greek word klepto, which means steal. It paints the picture of a bandit, a pickpocket, or a thief who is so skilled that his methods are almost undetectable. A pickpocket can slip their hand into somebody's pocket or purse, take what they want, and be long gone before that person even realized they've been robbed. Oh, don't fool yourself. The devil has you in his sights. He wants to get his fingers on every part of your life. He's a kleptomaniac, a spiritual pickpocket that's looking for an opportunity to wiggle his way into your personal affairs so he can walk off with everything you hold precious and dear. And that's not all. When he's through stealing all of your goods and possessions, then he'll take his plan of robbery homicide to the next level. He'll create circumstances and situations so terrible that you'll see no way to solve the problem except to give up that last bit of sanity that you had left over from the last time he attacked you. His plan is to waste and devastate your soul. And if he's not stopped, he'll leave you feeling spiritually shut down and emotionally out of business. And if possible, he'll have you thinking about taking your own life. I know I'm preaching to somebody out there. But on the flip side, Jesus said, I came that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. In other words, the Lord is telling us, I came that you might have, keep, and constantly retain a vitality, a gusto, a vigor, and a zeal for living. I came that you might enjoy unrivaled, unequal, overflowing life to the max. When the enemy tries to plant ungodly thoughts into your head, tell him, shut up in the name of Jesus. Make no mistake, his goal is for you to be defeated. He wants your life to be one struggle after another. He wants you to be constantly sick and depressed, down in the dumps, gloomy and miserable. He wants you to feel like nothing's ever going to change for you. But the devil is not the only one who got a plan for you. There is a way to put the brakes on his agenda. God's plan of redemption was mapped out in heaven before the world was formed and finished when Jesus died on Calvary's cross. Now, everything needed to make us righteous before God and redeemed from condemnation is found in the blood of Jesus. If possible, look at somebody and ask them, what more do we need? Now, I'm about to take my seat. I'm wrapping it up, but let me tell this story. One night, a pastor preached a sermon using this same text, 1 John 1 and 7. After the service, a stranger asked the preacher to walk home with him. Now, even though he was advised against it by the church officers who knew the man, the preacher went with him anyway. So ushering the preacher into the rear of a building, the stranger locked the door and put the key in his pocket and said, now, Reb, don't be afraid. I'm not going to hurt you. I just want to ask you a few questions. Do you believe all that stuff you preach tonight? The preacher replied, I most certainly do. The man continued, we're in the back of a saloon, a bar, and I'm the owner. Mothers come in here, lay their babies on the counter, and beg me not to sell liquor to their husbands, and I turn a deaf ear to their cry. We see to it that when a man leaves here, he's good and drunk. On more than one occasion, someone left here and was killed by a train when they staggered onto the tracks. So tell me, preacher, can God forgive a man like me? The preacher replied, I have but one authority, the word of God, which says the blood of Jesus Christ, God's son, cleanses us from all sin. But that's not all, added the man. In another room, we run a gambling joint. If a man don't spend all his money on liquor, we bring him back here, and with marked cards, with a stacked deck, we see to it that he's fleeced of every dollar he got, and we send him home without a penny. I'm the sole owner, preacher, so can you honestly tell me that God can forgive a man with a heart like that? Again, the preacher replied, I have but one authority, the word of God, which says, the blood of Jesus Christ, God's son, cleanses us from all sin. I'm not done, the stranger said. Across the street is my house where I live with my wife and little girl. Neither one has heard a kind word from me in about 5 years. Both of their bodies bear the scars of my anger and my rage. Now, preacher, do you think God could forgive a man with a heart like that? With his head looking down and tears running down his face, the preacher said, my friend, you have painted one of the darkest pictures I have ever gazed upon. But still, I have but one authority, the word of God, which says, the blood of Jesus Christ, God's son, cleanses us from all sin. The man opened the door, ushered the preacher back out into the night, but he didn't leave the saloon until daybreak, but not before tearing up every deck of cards and pouring every bottle of liquor he had down the sink. And when he got home, he sat silently in his living room. His little girl called out to him, Daddy, Mama says breakfast is ready. When he answered his little girl with a kindly response, she ran back to her mother shouting, "Daddy, talk nice to me, Mama. Something's going on." The mother followed her little girl to the living room where her husband had beckoned them both. And taking each one on a knee, he explained to their amazement that they had a new husband and a new daddy. He said, "I'm finished with that business across the street." The man later became a member and then an officer in one of the prominent churches of that city. And when folk asked how his life had changed so drastically, all he would ever say is, "The blood of Jesus." God's Son cleanses us from all sin. So the next time the devil tries to convince you that you're useless and beyond redemption, he ain't nothing but a liar. Look to the Bible, look to the Word of God, and this is what you will find out. You will discover that you're in good company. You'll discover that Noah was a wino. Abraham lied about his wife. Isaac was a daydreamer. Jacob was a con man. Moses stuttered and had a bad temper. Samson was cocky and a womanizer. David was an adulterer and a murderer. Elijah was suicidal. Jonah ran from God. Job was penniless, homeless, and covered with sores. Peter disowned Jesus 3 times. The disciples fell asleep during prayer meeting. The woman at the well had 5 ex-husbands and was shacking with her boyfriend. Zacchaeus had a short man syndrome, and Paul was a religious cutthroat. But by the blood of Jesus, God saved them and used them to turn this world upside down. So enough with the excuses. If God can change and use them, he can certainly change and use you. Somebody ought to give God some glory. I'm done. I believe with all my heart that this message has convicted someone of their sins and confirmed in their spirit that God has a plan for their life. If I'm talking to you, I invite you to pray this prayer, asking God to forgive you of your sins and make Jesus your Lord and Savior. If I'm talking to you, wherever you are, repeat this prayer after me. Lord God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I'm so sorry for my sins and for the life I have lived. I ask you to forgive me and cleanse me with your blood from all unrighteousness. For you said in your holy word that if I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead, you said I shall be saved. So right now, I confess Jesus as the Lord of my soul. And with all my heart, I believe that you raised him from the dead. And I accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. And according to your word, I am saved. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for dying for me and giving me eternal life. Amen. If you prayed that prayer and believe that you are now saved and on your way to heaven, I want to say to you, happy birthday. Because this Sunday morning, April 26, 2020, you got born again. We thank you for being here with us this morning. And we hope that the message made sense and you were blessed and encouraged by it. So until next Sunday, now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now, henceforth, and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 God bless you all.